So, since this is the first off talk of the conference, I thought I should just try and give a rather broad and non-technical overview of the issues that I see as especially relevant to the overall theme of the conference. So, when looking at the literature, I think it is possible to identify four themes on which there seems to be growing consensus among many economists. Especially in the various heterodox traditions, but also increasingly in the mainstream. The first, in my view, is the view that the rise in inequality has contributed in an important way to the US household debt crisis starting in 2007. Secondly, there is the by now widely held view that rising inequality at the international level has contributed to the so-called global imbalances in terms of national current account positions. Thirdly, there has recently been a shift of the focus of attention from merely looking at income inequality to also analyzing the longer-term implications of income inequality for wealth inequality. And fourthly, the argument has been made recently that high levels of inequality can, generally speaking, be a cause of low economic growth or even secular stagnation. It is obviously impossible for me to go into the details of each of these issues here, but I thought I could at least try and give you my personal view on how these very important issues are linked. Well, in fact, I should emphasize that almost everything I have done on this topic has been joint work. Together with Simon Sturm, who I think is also here today, we have written a survey article a while ago on income inequality as a cause of the Great Recession as part of a project with the International Labour Organization. And together with my colleagues from the IMK, Jan Behringer, Christian Belabet, and Thomas Theobald, we have been working on a project supported by the Institute for New Economic Thinking, or INET. And we have just recently published a short report on income and wealth inequality in Germany, which you can also find on the conference website. So I would like to first talk about the link between income inequality and macroeconomic instability. And here I will look in turn at the two, in my view, very interesting but also very different examples of the United States and Germany. And then I will talk briefly about our empirical results based on a macro panel analysis on current account balances. In the second part of the talk, which will be much briefer, I will talk about income and wealth inequality and how this is linked to my first point. And then thirdly, and this will just be a very short conclusion or outlook, I will argue that inequality may indeed turn out to be one of the main causes of demand stagnation in the future. Okay, this first chart, I guess, will be known to all of you. It is, of course, based on the World Top Incomes database set up by Thomas Piketty and his co-authors, and it shows the spectacular rise in the share of total pre-tax household income going to the very top of the income distribution, which started in the early 1980s. The second chart shows the equally spectacular decrease in the aggregate household saving rate, also starting in the early 1980s, to near 0% just before the crisis. This is the red line in the figure. The blue line shows that households' debt-to-income ratio in the US has increased very strongly over the exact same period, so starting again in the early 1980s. So what happened here? As a traditional Keynesian, in fact, you would normally expect that higher income inequality leads to a higher aggregate saving rate, because rich households have a lower marginal propensity to consume than poor households. However, models with upward-looking status comparisons, like some variants of the relative income hypothesis, actually predict just the opposite, that is a negative link between inequality and the aggregate saving rate. And according to this view, and which I think is basically correct, households below the top of the income distribution in the US have reduced their saving in order to try and keep up with the spending patterns of households at the top. Well, I think it is important to emphasize here that this is not at all about luxury consumption by the poor, but rather about basic middle class needs, like sending your children to relatively good schools or universities, living in relatively decent neighborhoods, or buying relatively good health care. All of these goods can be qualified as positional goods, because what really matters for the career prospects of your kids, for example, is the relative quality of their education, rather than its absolute quality. And then, obviously, when other people at the top of the distribution suddenly start to spend much more money on education, simply because their incomes increase very strongly, but at the same time your own income as a middle-class family is stagnant, then you can either send your kids to schools of lower quality, but this is obviously not what middle-class families aspire to, or you can reduce your saving and go into debt. And it should also be quite obvious that the institutional environment in the US, where all these basic needs essentially have to be paid for privately, puts enormous pressure on households to save less and go into debt as their relative incomes decrease. And as you can see in this chart, which I have taken directly from a new paper by Emmanuel Cez and Gabriel Zucman, it was really the bottom 99% of the wealth distribution in the US who strongly reduced their saving rates starting in the early 1980s, whereas the saving rate of the top 1% remained roughly stable. And you can also see here that especially households just below the top 1% have strongly reduced their saving rates, presumably in an attempt to keep up with the higher spending of the top 1%. And this here has in an important way driven the decline in the aggregate saving rate. And in this chart, which is taken from a paper by Michael Kumhoff from the IMF and co-authors, you can see that the rise in debt really took place within the bottom 95% of the distribution. This is the blue line here in the chart, and not at all at the top. So in this diagram, the debt to net worth ratio of the top 5% is the red line here, which has been essentially stable, but there has been a strong increase in the debt to net worth ratio for the bottom 95% of the income distribution. What I would also like to emphasize is the fact that the functional distribution of income, so the distribution between wages and profits, or if you prefer, between household income and corporate income, has actually remained quite stable in the US over the past few decades. I mean, even though the wage share, this is the red line here in the chart, has decreased somewhat, the share of total household income in national income, which I would argue is more relevant, has actually remained rather stable, or if anything, it has even slightly increased. This is the blue line here in the chart. So the implications of these trends for economic theory, at least in my view, are that firstly, models that focus exclusively on the functional income distribution, as is the case in many post-Keynesian and other heterodox models, may actually miss an important part of the inequality crisis nexus for the US. On the other hand, mainstream theories of consumption are totally unable to explain the decline in the household saving rate and the rise in household debt in the US after 1980. As is well known, the permanent income hypothesis or the life cycle theory of consumption they see no link between any given household saving rate and its relative income, or they see no link between their relative income and household saving rates. Rather, the theories try to explain this decrease in the aggregate saving rate by referring to the so-called wealth effect. But the wealth effect cannot explain why the saving rate of the top 1%, as we have seen, has actually remained rather stable, even though most of the increase in wealth has happened at the top 1%. And that's why, thirdly, I would argue that the current renaissance of the long-neglected relative income hypothesis of consumption, which is based on upward-looking status comparisons, is, in my view, highly warranted. Okay, so now I would like to talk about how I see the link between rising inequality and macroeconomic developments in Germany, which is a very different case from the US. So at first sight, the rise in inequality in Germany has been very similar to that in the US. At least when you look at the Gini coefficient of equivalized household disposable income, here you see the rise in the Gini coefficient from the mid-1980s to the mid-2000s for the US and for Germany, and it has been very similar during that period, and this is what the OECD typically looks at. But when you then look at top household income shares, and this chart is again based on the World Top Incomes database, top household income shares have actually been rather stable in Germany over the past few decades. And especially the top 1% household income share, this is the red line here, has not increased very much. So here I think that there is a kind of conceptual problem with Piketty's method, which is actually that trends in top household income shares are actually not directly comparable across countries because they ignore trends within the corporate sector, and the corporate sector is of course owned essentially by the rich households. So in Germany, for instance, the corporate sector has been a persistent net saver since 2002, but the retained corporate profits are obviously not counted as household income. And therefore, to the extent that the retained corporate profits ultimately increase, if not the income, then the wealth of top income households, top income shares a la Piketty underestimate the rise of top-end inequality in Germany, I would argue. So here in this chart as an illustration, you can see the rise in capital or profit income as a percentage of national income since the early 2000s in Germany. This is the red line here. And at the same time, you see a rise in corporate retained earnings as a share of disposable private income. This is the blue line here, starting in the early 2000s. And in the next chart, you can see what happens to top household income shares if you simply add the profits retained by corporations to top household incomes between 1995 and 2007. So the black fractions here of the bars in the diagram are corporate retained earnings, which have strongly increased over the period. I mean, of course, it would probably be excessive to argue that all the retained earnings should be counted as belonging to the top income households. And in fact, we would rather like to think of this diagram as a simple thought experiment, because it kind of shows you what would have happened to personal income inequality in Germany if the German corporate sector had behaved more like the US corporate sector, which has, of course, passed on their rising returns to top managers and shareholders, and thereby to the household sector. And the very different behavior of the German corporate sector is, of course, linked to the rather different institutional environment in Germany. The shareholder value orientation of firms is much weaker compared to the US, and very importantly, many firms are small and medium-sized enterprises, which are often family-owned. And so the main objective of German firms does not seem to be to pay maximum salaries and dividends to their managements and shareholders, but rather to accumulate large fortunes within firms and then perhaps pass them on to their children as inheritances at some point. And so as a conclusion, I would argue that what we call the corporate veil in Germany hides the rise in inequality between households, because the corporate retained earnings are not counted as household income, but it also restrains domestic demand to the extent that the rising retained profits are not spent by firms. And finally, and perhaps paradoxically, the corporate veil also reduces the pressure for the middle class to engage in debt-financed consumption, because rich households, which I would argue are the reference group for the middle class, have not increased their consumption spending proportionally to their incomes, but rather have increased their saving rate indirectly through corporate net saving. And then, of course, it is also clear that the mere ability of the middle class in Germany to engage in debt finance consumption is also restricted, because bank lending practices are much more conservative compared to the US, and also there is, of course, a much more extensive provision of public goods in Germany compared to the US. So, for example, the education system is largely publicly funded, and so there is less room for positional arms races, as we can observe in the US. Okay, in this final chart on Germany, you can see here that the corporate sector has indeed been in financial surplus ever since 2002. So the red fraction here of these bars is the corporate financial balance, which has been positive in every single year since 2002. And since, of course, the private household sector, this are the blue bars here, has also been in financial surplus, and the government is now also in financial surplus, and the German government is, of course, rather proud of this. The current account surplus of the German economy has obviously become structural. And this, of course, means that Germany contributes to macroeconomic instability at the international level, and that the weak domestic demand in Germany has been a major cause of macroeconomic imbalances in the euro area and also internationally. Now, some economists have argued that the current account surplus of Germany was actually due to especially weak investment spending. And so they have also argued that Germany should now deregulate its product and labor markets further in order to give a boost to investment. But in my view, this is not the correct diagnosis, because when you look at investment figures in more detail, actually you will see that the weak investment demand at the aggregate level was due primarily to the weakness of public investment and investment in housing, whereas business equipment investment has not been especially weak. And therefore, I would argue that really the main reason for the structural current account surpluses and the weak domestic demand in Germany is really the fact that consumer spending has been so weak, and that, in fact, firms are making excessive profits that they accumulate within firms, as you can see here. So, what we have done in our INET project, amongst other things, is to take a look at the relationship in a more systematic way between changes in top household income shares, personal income distribution on the one hand, and the functional income distribution of income on the other hand, across countries. And as you can see in these two charts here for the G7 countries and China, it is quite interesting to observe that it is actually precisely in those countries where top household income shares have increased most since the early 1980s. So here on the vertical axis, you see the change in top household income shares between the mid-1980s to the mid-2000s. And in those countries where top household income shares have increased most, United States, Great Britain, the decrease in the wage share has been smaller than in the other countries where the top household income shares have increased less. And also, and you can see this here on the right-hand side, in those countries where the top household income shares have increased most, the corporate financial balance, the corporate financial balance has increased less than in those countries where the increase in the top household income shares has been weaker. So in other words, top management salaries and profits paid out to shareholders in the Anglo-Saxon countries have, in a perhaps paradoxical way, stabilized wages and household income, while in countries like Germany, Japan, or China, the rise in profits and corporate net saving is actually hiding the true rise in income inequality when you just look at personal income inequality. And so in the next step, we estimated very standard current account equations on the basis of a macro panel including 20 countries for the period 1972 to 2007. And in these estimations, we control for standard determinants of current account positions like net foreign assets, the fiscal balance, the old age dependency ratio, population growth, and private credit. And then we included measures of personal income distribution, especially top household income shares, and measures of functional income distribution, that is the corporate financial balance and also the wage share. And what we found is actually that an increase in top income shares was linked to a decrease of the current account, while an increase in corporate net saving, or if you like as a robustness check, a decrease in the wage share, was linked to an increase in the current account. And we also found that the joint effects of these changes in the personal and functional distribution could explain a pretty large part of the current account imbalances before the crisis in otherwise very standard panel estimations. So in other words, in those countries where top household income shares increased strongly before the crisis, like the US, the UK, the other Anglo-Saxon countries, household saving rates have typically decreased. Household debt-to-income ratios have increased, and these countries had current account deficits. I think this is a pretty strong empirical regularity. On the other hand, in countries where the functional distribution shifted in favor of corporations, like Germany, Japan, or China, but the top household income shares increased less, domestic demand was weak, and these countries became increasingly dependent on net exports. So, as a conclusion, I would argue that rising inequality generally adds to macroeconomic instability, but it really depends on the country-specific nature of inequality, and of course also on country-specific institutions, if this macroeconomic instability materializes in the form of excessive household debt and current account deficits, or in the form of weak domestic demand and current account surpluses. Okay, so now I'd like to talk briefly about the links, the potential links between income and wealth inequality, and how they, and how this may be linked to what I've said so far. Okay, so first of all, I would like to remind you all of the much debated small model presented by Thomas Piketty in his bestseller Capital in the 21st Century. As you can see, I have put model in quotation marks because, well, actually it's not really a model, but it consists of one definition. This is the first equation here, and one, what I call here, arithmetic truism. And then Piketty also argues that there is this empirical tendency for the rate of return on capital R to exceed the growth rate of the economy G. Okay, so I'm not saying at all that Piketty's interpretation of the model is especially innovative, and in fact I recommend you to read the very interesting critique of his interpretation of the model by Bernardo Martinez and Stockhammer, which has just been published as a working paper. But I still think that simple variants of the model can be used for some simple and interesting thought experiments surrounding the relationship between income and wealth inequality, which I'm sure will be an important topic of this conference. So what is especially important for the dynamics of Piketty's model is the discrepancy, the gap, between household saving rates of high-income households and lower income groups. Because clearly, if the saving rate were independent of relative income, then R greater than G would have no effect whatsoever on income and wealth inequality, which would then be simply identical to wage inequality. And every household would be also the wealth to income ratios of households would also be independent of relative income. And so this is where I think that this very simple model can be related to what I said earlier, namely that the gap between top end and average saving rates has increased in many countries, including in the US and Germany, but in rather different ways. In the US and other countries, this gap has increased because lower income groups have actually reduced their saving rates to keep up with the higher spending patterns of the rich. While in Germany, it was actually the rich who have increased their saving rates indirectly through corporate retained earnings. And we have also micro evidence for this, the lower income groups have not significantly reduced their saving rates. So the rise in the gap between high income household groups and or high income saving rates and low income saving rates really comes from the higher saving rates of the rich. And so in both cases, and even irrespective of the exact relation between R and G, this increased gap between saving rates is likely to further exacerbate income and wealth inequality in the future, and far beyond any initial change in the inequality of wages, which is, of course, the traditional focus of attention for most mainstream economists, the distribution of wages. Okay, so in these simulations, and I will not go into the details, we have tried very simply to calibrate a very simple version of Piketty's very simple model to roughly fit the German data. And what we simply show is that given the rise in income inequality in recent years in Germany, and given that the gap between saving rates of rich and poor has also increased, it can be shown or it can be expected that wealth inequality has already risen substantially and that it will continue to rise substantially in the future in Germany. Now, while this may sound very obvious to you, I still think it's an important point to make in the public debate in Germany because German survey data based on the German socioeconomic panel, they seem to suggest that although income inequality has increased quite strongly over the past 15 years, that wealth inequality has actually remained rather stable. And so based on this very simple simulation, I think one can say that if income inequality increases and at the same time the gap between saving rates also increases, then it follows almost logically that wealth inequality has to also increase rather substantially in the future. Okay, my third part has only one slide. It is just basically my conclusion. So I have argued that inequality was an important cause of the global financial crisis, which has materialized in some countries in the form of over-indebted households, and in other countries in the form of over-indebted trading partners, if you like. So this is the export-led growth model. And so, at least to me, this inequality-induced debt overhang directly adds to the risk of secular stagnation. And so the obvious question to ask now is, where is demand growth to come from? Because in the US and other Anglo-Saxon countries, households are over-indebted, and the export-led countries also obviously have this problem of over-indebted trading partners. Some economists, as I said earlier, now complain about weak corporate investment, and they argue that we need structural reforms in the form of further deregulation of the product and labor markets to give a boost to investment. But really, to me, the real question is how consumer demand, which after all makes up for 60% to 70% of GDP, can recover as long as inequality keeps rising. I'm sure we are going to hear much more about this by Steve in the next presentation. So, very generally speaking, I would simply say that for demand growth to recover in a sustainable way, middle and lower class incomes would have to move at least in parallel with average trend productivity. And in fact, it would seem that some rather massive redistribution of income will be necessary to overcome the unsustainable debt-led and export-led models that we have seen before the crisis. Okay, and my last point is that simply I think that many macro models can still be improved by including both the functional and the personal distribution of income. Thanks very much.